gathered under one name. We are a tide that's rising, and we cannot be contained. Gathered under.
Good morning, everyone. How are you doing today? I love that song. That was kind of a rewrite of a song, Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Anybody heard that before, the original? Any old farts here in the building? Excuse me, sorry, I should say that. Old people that have remember that from way back. Charles Wesley, about 200 years ago, wrote that, and we just kind of, some people fixed it up. I think my mum would probably be turning in her grave along with Charles Wesley to know that we kind of changed the vibe there a little bit. But anyway, welcome to Kensington. Good to have you here this morning. My name's Colin. I'm one of the staff here at Kensington. It's great to have you here. If you're here for the first time this morning, we want to give you a special welcome. In fact, out in the lobby after the service, we have an area that's labeled Starting Point on a big sign out there. And if you're here for the first time, we'd love to meet you and get to know you a little bit. So please come and find us out in the lobby after the service where we can meet you and answer any questions that you may have. In a couple of weeks' time, in exactly 2 weeks' time, we have a baptism service here on this stage. We love baptisms because they're a symbol of people who are making that decision to follow Christ and make perhaps that private decision to follow Christ a public one. And so we're going to be doing that in 2 weeks today. So if you're somebody who would be interested in baptism, go to kensingtonchurch.org/baptism and then sign up there or find more information there. Or we can talk to you about it again at our starting point or at our info center out in the lobby. Now, you may or may not know this, but Thanksgiving is just around the corner. Did anybody know that? And then quickly on its heels, Christmas, of course. You're like, what? Halloween hasn't happened yet. But the Christmas decorations are already up in Macy's, so we know that like it's the holiday season already. And I love Thanksgiving because it just means lots of food and lots of fun time hanging out with family, two of my favorite things. But putting a great meal on the table is not as easy as you might think for some people in our community. And so we've made it a kind of a tradition and a value here to support families that are in need over their Thanksgiving time. And so each year, we've done this for like the last 22 years. Each year we gather kind of enough food to create hundreds of Thanksgiving baskets and then distribute them throughout our community. So we need many of you to take part in that and to sign up to help us on that Saturday before Thanksgiving to distribute Thanksgiving baskets around the community. Just essentially share the love of God with people that might be in need over the holiday. So you can sign up for that at kensingtonchurch.org/thanksgiving and just connect with us and let us know that you want to be a part of that. Another way that you can participate is to give. Obviously, if we're going to create, you know, a few hundred Thanksgiving baskets that cost about $50 each, that's tens of thousands of dollars. So we would love to have that supported from this community here. You can, again, go online and register your gift, give your gift there, or you can text your gift as well. So if you like to text stuff, you can do that. The number's on the screen behind me, and you can do that right now in the service. If you know that you get distracted and forget about it later, and you want to help a family this year with a Thanksgiving basket, that could be as little as $50 just to help a family in need there. So go ahead and text that too. Now, Danny Cox is with us this morning, and we'll be continuing in our series, Heart and Soul, Seven Things to Die For. So we're going to go right into that in just a moment. But before he does, I'd like to invite you to stand to your feet and just welcome some folks to church. And if you wouldn't mind moving into the middle, if you're at the sides, that would let people come in who are still on the way in the building. Thanks a lot.
Well, good morning, everyone. Grateful that you're here. My name is Danny, and like Colin said, we're in the sixth week of an eight-week series that we're calling Heart and Soul. And we're looking at really the heart and soul of our church in this place, and we're looking at what we value, our values. And we spend a lot of time saying, Lord, what is this? What is the heart and soul of this place? What do we value? Values are important. What you value as an individual, a corporation, a church, a family, kind of drives you. And so what we're hoping is our values line up with the heart of God, and we really believe they do. And so I wanted to just do a small recap of where we've been in some of our values. We have seven values. Today we're going to be talking about the fifth one. But our first one is in Christ, saying that Scripture says when we're in Christ, when we're in God, it means that we have an identity that we're His sons and daughters. And so we have this identity that's kind of a new creation is actually what Scripture says, that we are newly created into an identity that is rooted in Him. Under Scripture, we believe that the Word of God is the Word of God. That's what it is. And the Bible is His Word. It's a living Word, meaning that it is active and speaking to us all the time, and it's our place that we get authority, our true north. As a family, in Scripture, many times God talks about the church as a family because we believe that our actual growth is happening in community, not in isolation. And many times we find ourselves isolated. We're saying, no, we work as a family. For the one last week, Steve Norman, who is our lead teacher here, he really led us well in this. And I would say this value, out of all of our values, is so core to who we are. And what it means is, if you know our new mission statement, is to see everyone, one in parentheses, transformed and mobilized by Jesus. And so we're always having the eye for the one, the person that's far from God. I was that person 17 years ago, standing in the back. And I'm so grateful for this community having an eye for the person that God is drawing to Himself and calling that person to that. And today we're going to be talking about from brokenness. We're going to be talking about our brokenness and how we live an authentic life. And that's hard to do. The Scripture says that all of us have broken parts of who we are. We're not perfect. We're not perfect. But is there a way we can live authentically? And to live authentically and live real is really hard to do. It's hard to be real with people. But could you imagine what it might look like if we were real and authentic? We just spoke what's on our heart. And so I could imagine maybe some of our business dealings might look a little something like this.
Right. Okay. Well, this here's a load-bearing wall. We'll go ahead and rip that out. It's going to cause a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. Totally unnecessary. And it triples the budget.
We'll be way behind schedule.
Schedules.
Schedules. Great.
Okay. Over there's good.
So how much longer do you think this will take?
I'll over-explain the process, then give you an unrealistic timeline.
I'll nod in agreement, so my wife thinks I understand what you're saying.
I look forward to questioning your every move.
Okay, well, I'll leave your house in shambles and disappear for 6 months.
I love that. I'll leave your house in shambles and disappear for 6 months. You know, how many have gone through that? I have. But wouldn't that be great if we could just say what's on our mind? I think about the people in the dating scene right now, even when I used to be in that scene before I got married. What would our dates look like? What would our communication look like if we just spoke what's on our mind? Maybe it would look like this.
Hi.
Hey.
I've made plans for later in case this date doesn't go well.
Likewise, but funny story, on top of that, my mom is my best friend.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
Oh, there's the rescue text from my roommate saying she needs me. I've had a wonderful time tonight.
Me too.
Call me tomorrow?
I'm gonna send a vague text in a couple days that leaves you confused about my level of interest.
I'll wait a full 2 days before responding.
Perfect. We're never gonna see each other again, will we?
No.
I love it. Well, I had some just crazy dating stories, but when I watched that, I just thought of one in particular. I don't even know why I'll tell you, but it's just fun. So there's a point to it, but I remember going out on this one date. I didn't know this person very well, and I call her on the phone, and I thought, well, maybe the first date we'll go see a movie, of course, kind of typical. So I, you know, in the movie theater, there's like 15 movies or something. So I started going down the list. Yeah, hey, do you want to see this one? No, I can't see that one. How about this? No. How about this? Well, I don't like those. I went through every one. Finally, I got to the last one. It was like some Disney movie. I think it was like Call of the Wild or something like that. And she goes, okay, I can do that. I was like, okay, we'll go to that. So I go to her house. I walk in. Her parents are kind of catatonic. They're just staring at each other. They never look at me. There's a big cage with big dogs, and they're like, rrr, rrr, rrr. I'm telling you, this is really weird. And then she comes out. I'm like, okay, well, let's go. And we're kind of strangers. We go to the movie. We get into the movie theater. We sit down. Now, this is a Disney movie, and we're sitting there. And we're watching, and all of a sudden there's like this bear comes up and he's gonna get the kid. And the bear comes up like this, and all of a sudden I hear her go, oh no, oh no, oh, oh. And I look over and I'm like, are you okay? And she's like, uh-huh, yeah, I'm fine. Uh-huh. And then the bear gets a little more aggressive, and all of a sudden she goes, not kidding it. And I leave her, I'm like, are you okay? It's just a movie, it's just, it's like, it's a fake bear, you know what? No, I'm good. And then it passed. And then there's another scene where all of a sudden the kid slides down the mountain. He slides over this pond, and the pond starts breaking, or this lake, and he's going to fall in. And all of a sudden she starts that again, and it's like, and then she yells, and she just runs out of the theater. And I'm there by myself. I'm not kidding. It's me and two other people. And I start laughing. I'm like, what's happening to me right now? She comes back like 20 minutes later, sits down. I go, are you okay? And she's like, oh, yeah, I'm fine. It's fine. Are you sure? Oh, yeah, I'm good. You know, so you can imagine how that date ended, right? Like, we're not gonna, you know. But, you know, I dropped her off, and then, well, I did call her back, and we ended up dating, and she became my wife. But that's a different story. No. I'm totally lying. That is not my wife. It is a true story, but she didn't become my wife. The fact of the matter is this. It is so hard to be authentic in our relationships. It's hard. And so much of the time when we meet people, we have sort of these masks on. We don't want them to see our true self. And so we've learned to kind of mask that and hide that. And it's kind of a human thing. You see, in our social media, it's unbelievable. Like, someone will take 1,000 selfies to get the right angle. Not me, because there's no right angle here. Just let you know. But someone will take that many selfies just to make sure that what they're portraying is perfect. But we're not. We're not perfect people. And that's clear. And so the last thing we want to do is live our lives out of our false self. We don't want to go through this life and not know who we really are, our authentic self, the way God has made us. And so our lead pastor at the Orlando campus, Kevin Valentine, has a thought for us, and he's going to lead us in this, because the last thing we want to do in our lives is to get through this life faking who we really are.
Every day, when you look in the mirror, do you like what you see? Are you happy with how you look? With who you are? Or do you feel a need to conceal the lines, the wrinkles, the secrets? What is it that makes us try to be something that we aren't? Is it the pressure of living up to the expectations of our coworkers, our friends, our family, ourselves? So we pretend. We pretend we have it all figured out. Afraid that we would be discovered to be a fraud, we put on a mask. Can you imagine a community of people who lived from their brokenness, who revealed their weaknesses and didn't feel the need to hide and cover up and pretend? A community where God's power was revealed on a daily basis through the fact that there was no faking and no judging of others. That kind of community could change the world. I remember when I was roaming halls like these in high school, and the pressure that I felt to measure up, to be liked, to fit in, to belong. I think we all felt that. And the question is, why do we wear masks? So many of us are driven by what other people think of us. And because of that, we hide who we really are. The Apostle Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament, he looked inside his heart and wrote about what he saw. He says, "For nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For the good I want to do, I do not do. But the evil that I don't want to do, this I keep on doing." And he's talking about something that we all know. We all struggle with sin. But it's not the struggle with sin that bothers those outside the church. It's that those of us inside the church hide it. We pretend like we've got it all figured out. And then we point fingers at and look down at people who struggle with sin. We want to be a community of people who humbly reveal our weaknesses and our shortcomings, who lead from our brokenness. A community without the pressure to measure up and to look our best. A safe place where you can be yourself. And that starts with knowing who we are in Christ. Because what God says about us is more important than what people think about us. And in Ephesians 2:10, it says that we are God's masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus to do good works that God planned for us long ago. And if that's true, that means we don't have to pretend. We don't have to hide our flaws and our brokenness. In the Bible, we know that the Apostle Paul had a weakness. He had brokenness in his life that he asked God multiple times to remove. And we find God's answer to him in 2 Corinthians, where he says, "Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." And he says, "I'll boast gladly about my weaknesses, my hardship, and insults, and persecution. For when I am weak, then I am made strong." God's answer to Paul was no. And so Paul, rather than hiding his weakness and pushing his brokenness aside and pretending to be something he wasn't, he embraced it. He talked about it. He brought it up. Paul realized that the strength of following Jesus wasn't in hiding his brokenness and presenting a perfect exterior, but rather the strength in following Jesus was revealing his weakness and in that weakness being strong. Thank you.
Living this out has been a journey for me. Back when I roamed halls like these in high school, I was an athlete. That's what I was. I played golf, and I played beach volleyball at a high level. When I got to college, I played collegiate golf and on the men's indoor volleyball team for Oakland University. That's what I was. At the age of 24, newly married to the girl of my dreams, tragedy struck my life. I was helping a lady change a tire and was hit by a car going 50 miles an hour, crushed between the back bumper of the van and her car. I woke up 10 days later an amputee. Sports were over for me, so I thought. 4 months later, I learned to walk. I received my first prosthetic. And as soon as I was able to use it, I had them build it up and put synthetic skin on it and make it look exactly like my other leg. I had a lot of reasons why I wanted that, very practical reasons. One, I wanted to make it easier for other people. It looked better when I was wearing pants. It made it easier to line up my golf shots. It was more protective when we had little kids. But those weren't the real reasons. The real reasons were I was afraid that other people would think I was less of a man. I was afraid that other people would see me and think I was less of a leader and less than in general. And if I'm really honest, I felt less than. I felt less of a man, less of a leader, because I couldn't do the things I could do before. So for 12 years, I kept that cover on, hoping to hide my brokenness. Until one day I was getting a new leg made, and the guy who makes my legs asked me a question. He just says, "Why do you want your leg covered anyways?" And I gave him my list of reasons, none of them the real reasons. And then he made a statement that changed me. He looked at me and he said, "But God made you that way. Why do you want to cover that up?" And I didn't have an answer. And my first thought was, well, God didn't make me that way, but that's how I am now. And all my other reasons for covering up my leg just fell flat. As I realized that I was trying to hide what was now a part of me. That was the last day I wore the cover. Because as I look at it, if Scripture is true, that God's power is made perfect in weakness, why would I want to live my life covering mine up? What would happen if we decided to take off the mask, to let others in, to be vulnerable? What if it's not at all like what we expect? What if it's in the very weakness that we're trying so hard to disguise that we find strength, that we find freedom? Today, God is inviting you into real relationships, ones where you no longer have to fear being you. Life is too precious to spend hiding in the dark. So step out into the light and take off the mask.
You know, something Kevin would never really say, I don't think, but one thing that I know about him is, you know, the leg that they saved, though it was great that they saved the leg, it's been so painful for him. It's like every step he takes in his life is pain and a reminder of his brokenness, every step. He's constantly in pain in his body, and he's reminded of it every day. And that kind of continence that he has, that look on his face that he has in that video, that's what he's like all the time. Every time I've ever seen him, he's had this smile and this joy about him. To be honest with you, he's like one of our heroes in our midst, our heroes of faith. I think about myself in that situation, and I don't know how I would handle it. And I look at Kevin and think, wow, he says he thinks he's lesser than. We don't look at him that way at all. I look at him as like, wow, I want to be like that. And he has discovered this power in what people might call brokenness or weakness or how he sees that. He's discovered something different. And I like the sub-story that's happening in there too, this idea that, you know, that this guy's going to the reunion. How many of you have gone to reunions? I only went to my fifth year. I never went to another one. You know, sorry, Centerline High School. But boy, it's something where we try to put on a front, and it's something that we aren't really. But when we get home and we lay our heads on our pillows, we know who we are. And that is what we want to look at today. Lord, how can we live wide open? How can we recognize the broken things of our life, but surrender them to you and have you speak to who we really are? That's what we want to discover today. Let me pray. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity through you that we can have a new identity, that we can live as a family and community, that we can be connected to each other and we have authority through your word. And so, Father, we want you to we ask you if you would guide us in a way that is everlasting, a way that you can speak into the eternal parts of our life and not let us identify with the broken things, but rather the redeemed things through you, Lord. We want to know that today. And so guide us in that way, Lord. Speak to our hearts as you always do, but give us ears to hear your voice, eyes to see your face. Amen. Well, we thought it was kind of funny that we would call this one Mask and it would land on Halloween weekend. It wasn't planned. You know, Seth, our video director, sent out an email and goes, I can't believe we're on Halloween weekend and we're doing this. It wasn't planned at all, but I think it's beautiful. I mean, how many people are gonna actually pass out candy to your neighbors this Halloween? Let me see your hands. All right, don't be shy. I mean, I'm not gonna call you out for being part of a pagan holiday in church. It's no big deal. Take down names. No. How many of you are actually gonna go trick-or-treating? Admit it. I even had some adults say yes. I was like, really? You guys do that? That's awesome. And then how many of you are gonna go for it and get the whole deal, the whole costume, put all the time and energy and effort into doing that? How many of you are gonna do that? A lot of you. Wow, look at you guys. The fact of the matter is to wear a mask one day a year, a couple days a year, have fun, that's great. But here's what's true. There are some of us in this room that have felt like they've worn a mask their whole life. They've worn a mask their whole life. Some of us have felt that. Some of us are doing that. Sometimes it's seasonal. Sometimes it's weeks or months. But we have these masks that we put on. Sometimes we don't even know that we're wearing them. You know, it's interesting. We thought we'd have some fun. We picked out a few masks. This is Captain America, right? It doesn't quite fit on me. But this mask is interesting to me. Maybe it is for other men in this room. I can't speak for women. But for me, I grew up, my dad was like a big dude. You know, he was a fighter. He was in the Navy. He would talk about all these rumbles he'd get in. It would be like the Jets and the Sharks, dun, 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 you know. But he would talk about it. He was like a macho, real guy. I wasn't like that. And so when I grew up, I didn't realize it. Now, my dad never pushed that on me, which is beautiful about him being a father. But I always felt like I had to live up to that. So I didn't realize that I was always trying to have this mask on, to be a hero, to not show emotion. Men shouldn't be emotional. Men shouldn't cry. Men shouldn't do that thing. You know, so I was always having this mask on. I would say it wasn't until I was probably in my early 30s when I met Christ. It was the first time that God kind of revealed and said, you have a mask on. This isn't even who you are. That was the first time I ever realized that. That's not that long ago. This one here, Mardi Gras mask. It's kind of a lame Mardi Gras mask. Like, we should have a really big one, right? But this is kind of the party mask. This idea that life's a party, everything's fine, everything's good. I worked with someone for a couple of years where this was their mask. It was everything was fun, everything, nothing's wrong, everything's a party, everything's gonna be fine. And then when this got taken off at the end of the day and some of the conversations we had, it was unbelievable. This kind of hurt that existed. And then, of course, this mask is one we've been seeing recently. The scary, and this is the autonomous. We don't want to be known. We have this mask on. We're just trying to hide. We want to be anonymous. We don't want anyone to know who we are. We have this mask on, but the fact of the matter is, I think deep down we want to be known, but we hide. And we have this on. We don't want people to know who we really are. And why do we wear these masks? There's tons of reasons why we wear masks. Most of it is built around two little words, self-protection. We want to protect ourselves. Maybe it's built around shame. We're ashamed about something that we've done or that it's been done to us. We have fear. We're afraid that people will find out who we really are. And so we have fear about that. And we don't want people to know what's actually the dark parts of our hearts, our minds, our souls, our thoughts. We're scared that someone will reject us for our humanness and for our brokenness. There's many reasons we wear the mask. But here's what I want you to know today. There's one thing that I know for sure that every single person in this room and in this world and on stream and everywhere have in common. We are not perfect. We are broken. Every one of us has things from our past, things in our heart, things in our soul. That's one of the human traits that all of us can agree on. I mean, if there's a perfect person in this room, you just need to get up and leave because you've got to figure it out. But it's not reality. It's not true, and God knows that about us. There's only one perfect person that ever walked the earth. That's Jesus Christ. That's it. And one of the attractive qualities about this particular church when I came here 17 years ago, I walked in the door. I remember hearing preachers stand up here. I remember one time Steve Andrews was up here, and he was talking about his marriage, and he said, Paula, his wife, he goes, yeah, Paula got to the point where she's going to leave me. She just thought, you are useless. I don't want to have anything to do. I thought, are you really saying that in front of all these people? Like, what are you doing? That's a big no-no, because in my tradition, in my church tradition, that would never happen. When I was a little kid, I thought that the priest or the preacher was absolutely flawless, that they knew God, that they were 1,000% in his presence, and there was nothing wrong with them. And never realized that that's not true. I mean, I know I look perfect, and I know you think that about me, but it's not true. Because we're all human. I mean, it's mainly true, but it's not true, right? But we're human. Now, don't get me wrong. I believe as we move towards God and as we move towards his light, he purifies us. He makes us more like him. He makes us more righteous. I believe that. That's why I'm up here, to tell you that today, that you can overcome your brokenness with him, that you are not your brokenness, that you're not defined by your brokenness, you're not defined by what has been done to you, you're not defined by the things that you've done. It's not true, but what is true is we're all broken and we're not perfect. And we need a way to deal with that. And I really believe that scripture gives us that way. And we see that we have a particular bent. It's always been like this since the beginning of time. If you know scripture, Genesis 1 and 2 is a perfect picture of what God intended man and earth and creation to be. Genesis 1 and 2, we're in perfect harmony with God, creation. We have this unbelievable relationship with God where everything is wide open, nothing is hidden. And then in Genesis chapter 3, something happens that we label the fall. Meaning that man's decided to look at God and say, I don't want what you've given me. I'm turning away from it and doing it my way. And they did the one thing that God asked them not to do. And so they made a mistake. And I want to pick it up there because I think right in that chapter, we start to see the humanness of who we actually are and how that's happening to all of us in this room still to this day. Let me read it to you. The man, Adam, and his wife, Eve, heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. This is after they made their mistake. And they, what? And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Their first instinct when they made a mistake was what? To hide. First thing. But the Lord God called to the man and he said, where are you? Now I want... There are people here on stream and in this room that have no idea why they're here today. But I want to tell you something. This is what God says to us every day. Where are you? Where are you? I want to see you. Where are you? It's a beautiful reaction. He's saying, where are you? And the Adam answered. He said, I heard you in the garden and I was what? Afraid because I was naked and so I hid. So right in this moment where we make mistakes, what happens? Fear comes in. He's afraid of the one just minutes potentially before that he was in perfect relationship with. Now all of a sudden he has fear and shame. He's never felt that before, by the way. In Genesis 3 is when fear and shame entered the world. And so all of a sudden now he's afraid. And what is he afraid of? He's afraid to be exposed. So I'm afraid to be exposed. I'm afraid that you will see all of who I am. And so what does he do? He hides. They hide. That is happening now all the time. That is our human instinct. And that was when the first mask was put on. First mask was put on there. See, and you know what happens? A false self starts to develop. a false self. It's like, that's not how I made you to be. That's what God's saying to him. Hey, where are you? He has a mask on, first mask ever put on. You know, it's interesting. I read a book years ago. I think it was written by Scott Peck. I think his name was Scott Peck. He was a road less travel author and wrote a number of books. And he wrote one called The People of the Lie. I don't remember the book that well. But it was written a long time ago. I didn't even look at it this week. But the one part that I remember is he would talk about people that would lie and they would tell a few lies. And then at some point they would start to believe one of the lies and they would start to build their life on that. And pretty soon they were built upon something that was completely false. That's what happens to us many times in our life. We're told something, something's done to us, we start to believe that that's who we are, we put the mask on, we get used to the feel of the mask, we get used to how it looks, we get used to how people respond to it, and we start to become something that my friend Jamie always says is a false self. It isn't even who we really are. We start to believe that. And it's fascinating in scripture when you read about the interactions with Jesus and people, he's always talking to this. Every time he speaks to this, when you read, every time with his disciples, with people that he meets, he's always speaking into their false self and reminding them who they really are. Last week, Steve Norman talked about the woman at the well. It's a beautiful picture because the woman at the well went to the well in the noonday sun. Because all the other women would go in the morning and she knew how she was viewed. She had a particular reputation that wasn't good in that particular city. And Jesus met her there. And at one point he says, this is who you actually are. I know you've had multiple husbands. I know that you're living with someone that's not your husband, but that's not, and you know what he's saying to her? He's saying, listen, take off the mask. I already know who you are. That's not who you are. You've believed a false self and you're living it out. There's a great story about a rich young ruler. The rich young ruler comes to Jesus and he looks at him, he says, hey, prophet, how do I attain eternal life? And they get in this conversation. And at one point towards the end of this conversation, Jesus says, sell everything you own and come follow me. And it says that the rich young ruler went away sad. What's Jesus saying to him? Take off your mask. You're not your wealth. You're not the things that you have accumulated. That's not who you are. Take off your mask. I love the story of Zacchaeus. He's a tax collector. He's a short man. He's hated in that community. He hears about Jesus coming into the city. He gets up onto a tree so he can be over everyone and get a glimpse of this prophet, this savior. And all of a sudden, Jesus sees him and he calls him by name. Zacchaeus, come down from there. Take me into your home. Let's have a meal together. And we know that his mask was removed then because his whole life changed in that moment. Zacchaeus made a complete 180 and says, whatever I've done before, I'm going to make amends to this. And Jesus is like, take off your mask. That's what he's saying. That's what he's saying to us today. He's saying, take off your mask. I already know who you are. He knows something we don't know. And this is beautiful. The reason Jesus keeps saying to us, take off our mask, is he knows that when we see our brokenness, there's an exchange that can happen with him. He knows that it's not who we are. He says this in Luke 8. Listen to what he says. For all that is in secret will eventually be brought into the open. He knows eventually this is going to come out. And everything that is concealed will be brought to the light and made known to all. It's going to be brought to the light anyways. He's like, come to me. Why does he say that? Here's why I think he says that. There's a couple of reasons. And Paul, Kevin hinted to it. I'll get to that in a minute. But here's one reason that hit me this morning as I was driving in to speak today. There's a beautiful exchange that happens when we come to Jesus and we give him our broken things. He's saying, scripture says that there's no darkness in him at all. So when he exposes his light and we are in his presence, that light comes in and exposes our darkness. And here's what happens. Many times we're terrified by that. And Jesus says, guess what's gonna happen? If you look at your brokenness and you see it and you come to me, I have a beautiful exchange that I wanna do with you. He says, you give me your broken things. Hand them to me. My anger, my this, my that. And I'm gonna give you something else. Here, I'll give you an example. When we are single and we're doing our own thing, guess what happens? We think we're perfect. Like when I was single, I was like, I'm awesome. Then I got married and I'm like, wow, she's really bad. No, she's got a lot of brokenness about her. Nothing wrong with me, I'm still awesome. Then we had kids. Wow, these kids are nasty. No, it's just, They got a lot of brokenness in them. That's true. They're born with original sin. I see it. No. So, but here's what happened. Our brokenness is played out in our relationships. When we're by ourselves, we can do whatever we want. We have no idea. That's not entirely true, but in our minds. But our brokenness starts to come to the surface in our relationships. So when I got married, wow. And I really did think for a long time it was her. It was Amy. We had kids, and then here's a turning point. This is what happened to me. We had kids, and they weren't obeying me, and I felt disrespected. And my little boy, Ben, he was probably about 5 years old, and he did something, and it was disrespectful. And I came up over him, and I was angry, and I'm like, you shouldn't do that. Now, I'm a big guy. He's a little guy. And he looks at me, and I'll never forget his face. He's like, he's terrified. And I remember God whispering something to me. He's like, your son is scared of you. Don't do that. I don't do that to you. Don't do that to your son. Wow, man. That was a moment where I realized something. I had anger, like deep-seated anger in my heart. I had no idea why I had it. And it was being triggered. My brokenness was being triggered by these beautiful kids. Isn't that ridiculous? And that started me on a journey. And here's the journey. As I moved closer to Jesus, guess what started to happen? He started to say, listen, there's one thing you need to know. Your brokenness is contagious. People catch it. Your brokenness is contagious. And if you don't deal with it, guess what? That little boy is gonna have anger in his heart. That's what started to happen, by the way. Both my boys, I noticed this kind of aggressive, kind of angry thing. I'm like, oh, Lord. I mean, luckily, I caught that one a bit early. I still think they had a little bit, but I caught it early, and God started to show me how to deal with that. And this is what happened. I would go to God with this. I'm like, Lord, I don't know where this is coming from, but I'm going to hand this to you. And the scripture says that the Spirit has fruits. That's how you know he's working in your life. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. Self-control being the last one because it's so hard. And he's got these 9 fruits. And you know he's working in your life when you see someone else. So here's what happens when you go to God with your brokenness. This is why Jesus wants you to come to him. He just wants you to come to his table. He wants to give you a gift. Here's the gift. He says, give me your anger and I'll give you patience. Give me your jealousy and I'll give you love. Give me your inability to control yourself, and I will teach you how to have self-control. And guess what? All of these fruits, these 9 fruits, are rooted in eternal things. And he's saying, don't pass your brokenness on through your family line and your legacy. Let me take your brokenness, redeem it, and pass on the things that are of me that will go on forever in your legacy. Which, by the way, has nothing to do with me. That's why we struggle with it. So I want it to be my legacy. And the Lord's like, no, no, no. Give me your humanness. I'll give you something supernatural and pass that to your kids. Pass that to your coworkers. Pass that to your wife. Pass that to your family. Pass that to this community. Pass that to this nation. Pass that to this world. Do you realize that's what he's saying? There's a mission in this. Give me your brokenness. And as I start to reveal this, you get to give people what is actually eternal. That is the beautiful exchange that God offers us. That's the beautiful exchange that he offers us. And Paul, when he went, the Apostle Paul went to God. He's like, God, listen, I have this brokenness in me. They called it a thorn. He said, I have this thorn in me. And he goes to God. Now, we don't know what the thorn was. It was brokenness. It could have been some people think it was epilepsy. Some people think that it was actually a physical ailment. Some think that it wasn't. Some think that it was a moral thing. There's all kinds of theories. It doesn't matter. The point is, Paul went to God and said, I have a thorn, and I want you to take it away from me. And he asked him 3 times, and the Lord says, no. And then Paul says, I heard something, and this is what I heard. He said, but God said to me, my grace, this unmerited favor that we don't deserve, is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. My power is made perfect in weakness. When I hand God my brokenness, guess what we get? We get his fruits and we get his power. And in that moment, Paul had a moment in his life where He had a complete change. He's like, whoa, 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 wait a minute. If that's true, what does this mean? This is what he says. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses. Now, come on. Who in this room boasts about their weaknesses? Tell me. Just yell it out. Do you boast about your weakness? Yes? No. You don't? There's no one in here that's boasting about their weakness and gladly boasting about his weaknesses. But Paul has an epiphany. So that what? Christ's power may rest on me. He's saying, awesome. If this is true, and my brokenness actually can be reversed, and these things can be exchanged, and I can have power over my weakness as long as I don't hide them, here we go. Take everything I have, Lord. Because if that's the truth, guess what happens? Power moves through my family, through my relationships. Power moves. And we have access to this perfection that continues to perfect us in this life. It's a powerful thought, isn't it? And most of the time we're like, no, God, you don't get to have my anger. You don't get to have my jealousy. Sorry, it's mine. I'm going to hold on to it. I love it. Love my anger. It's awesome. Really like my jealousy. It's really who I am. I do not want your peace. I don't want your love. I don't want any of that stuff. I like what I have. And God's like, are you kidding me right now? That's what's happening. I have a couple thoughts for you about how we can take these masks off just by a journey I've had in the last year and a half. We'd like to receive our offering. We're going to take communion as well at the end, which I'm excited about for all of us to take communion together. So you come prepared to give. Thank you so much for that. We're grateful for that because we believe that this community can have power and can change the world through this exchange. And so part of this giving and part of that of our worship helps us to do that. So thank you. If you're brand new here, doesn't have to be your moment at all. Honestly, it doesn't have to be your moment. But if this is your home, partner with us. If you want to partner, great. But I want to give you a couple practical thoughts that I've learned over the last year and a half. A friend of mine, Bill Kaiser. Bill's a great guy. He's part of our Celebrate Recovery. And if you're part of Celebrate Recovery, it's a place on Monday nights here, Tuesday nights in Lake Orion, where we actually, I would say it's probably the most authentic, real group of people that we have in this place. It's people that gather to talk about their brokenness and not only talk about it, but to actually jump in and figure out how God's gonna solve this brokenness in their life. It's an incredible community. And if you're involved in any recovery, you know that there's something called a 12-step. Well, in this particular movement, there's something called a year-long step study. And so I was walking up the aisle one time. Bill usually sits back there, and he got a gruff voice, and he's like, hey, Danny, I got to talk to you. I'm like, okay, Bill, what do you got to say? He's like, hey, you're up there as a pastor telling everyone they need to do the 12-step thing. He goes, you need to do it. Don't tell people to do something you're not willing to do. I was like, wow, Bill just convicted me, you know? So I told him, I said, yeah. And I said, would you lead me? And he's like, yeah. So we got a little group of people together. We started about a year and a half ago. It works through four books. And the idea is that you drill down deep into some brokenness. And there was a few things that I was noticing somewhat similar to my anger years ago. I was like, I don't like how I always do this. I want to get to the bottom of it. And so we've been meeting for a year and a half. And one of the first things that you do, oh, by the way, Kevin said it took him 12 years. 12 years to get to a point of acceptance to say, I'm going to change this leg. That's what he said, 12 years. I want to encourage you. Brokenness and stepping into that process could be a long-term, lifelong thing. Don't get frustrated by that. Sometimes it doesn't happen like this. In fact, most of the time it doesn't. And in my particular step study, it wasn't until 2 weeks ago, after a year and a half of this, that I felt like God finally drilled down to the bottom of something. That was almost a year and a half of meeting, and it's been beautiful. But the first thing you learn in this is the Serenity Prayer. How many people know the Serenity Prayer? A number of you know that. Reinhold Niebuhr was one of the guys that's credited to. He was actually a pastor in Detroit from 1915 to about 1928. And he's credited with that. He started using that in a lot of his sermons in the 1930s. And here's the first part of this Serenity Prayer. God, grant me the serenity, the peace, the stillness to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. That is my first 15 years of marriage right there, honestly. God grant me the peace to accept the things I cannot change. I spent the first 15 years of my marriage trying to change my wife. Worst thing I ever did. But I thought it was all her. Courage, which mainly it was, but no. But courage to change the things I can. When I finally realized I don't need to change my wife, I need the courage to look here. When that moment happened, when Amy was like, this isn't working anymore, I don't want to be in this anymore. When that Steve Andrews Paul moment happened in my life, I was like, whoa, I actually need to do something. And that wasn't that long ago. Mr. Pastor Boy has a lot of issues, right? And it was a beautiful moment because at that point, I'm like, okay, what do I have to learn, Lord? What do I have to change? He gave me the courage and he gave me the wisdom to know the difference. And when that moment happened, things started to change. Now, there's a whole nother section to this prayer. I'd love you to look it up when you get home. I didn't even know it existed. I don't have time to give you that, but look that up. But there's three things that I've noticed that I've been able to do in this year-long step study. The first thing I would say, this is what I would say, search, speak, and surrender. Search, speak, and surrender. The first one is search. There has to be a moment in time where you search your heart. That moment when Amy looked at me and said, this isn't working and I'm done, that's a searching of my heart. I can blame her or I can search my heart. But I started searching and looking. And as I searched in that, I started letting God search me. And that is a beautiful moment when you let God search your heart. Psalm 139 says it beautifully. It says this. It says, you have searched me, Lord, and you know me. So if you haven't read Psalm 139, read it. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. For you created my inmost being. When we are in Christ, we are a new identity. That's that right there. God created our inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. And then he says this, search me, God. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me. Some scripture says, see if there's any evil in me and remove it. And it says, and lead me in your way everlasting. Now, this is one thing about the scripture I love. We shouldn't have to ask God to search our hearts because he already has. But he wants us to come to him and say, God, search me. When we get to that point, we have a chance. When we see our brokenness and we put our arms up and say, God, search me. And that's a dangerous prayer, by the way. Search my heart, God. And lead me in your way everlasting. Something remarkable happens in that moment. Number two, to speak it out. So when he searches us and he shows us, we need to speak it out. We need to, what we say, confess. Father, I see this and I see it's not of you. I don't want this. I want to give it back. This is what scripture says about that. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves. We're lying to ourselves if we say we have no brokenness. And the truth is not in us. If we confess, if we say out loud and we admit to God of our sins, he is faithful and he is just and will forgive us our sins and what? Purify us from all unrighteousness. There's the exchange. Tell me and I will start to purify you of all unrighteousness and give you righteousness. It's a beautiful exchange. Proverbs says this, whoever conceals their sin does not prosper, but the one who confesses and renounces them finds mercy. And so we search ourselves, we have God search our heart, we confess it out, and then we surrender to him. And this is the moment where we lay down our masks. This is the moment where I'm like, wow, Lord, this, not me. I surrender that. Here you go. I can't do anything with these. I've tried. I can't do anything. I'm surrendering them to you. I'm yielding to you. And this is what Matthew says about that. Then Jesus said to his disciples, the people that want to follow him, that want this beautiful exchange, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Whoever does this, I want this anger. I want this stuff. Guess what? This dies. This amounts to nothing. This doesn't have eternal value. But listen to the exchange. But whoever loses their life for me will find it. Will find it. Whoever says, it's not me, Lord, I need you. Boom, in that moment, you actually find true life. That's where true life exists. The world tells us a lot of things. That's true life. That's where that exists. That's the beautiful exchange. There's nothing to be ashamed of. God isn't looking at you and saying, you're far beyond your brokenness. You'll never be repaired. Sorry. Doesn't exist in his world. Not at all. He's saying, come to me. All you who have burdens and that need rest, come to me. He's saying, all of you that are tired of your mask management, that you have a PhD in from BS University, come to me and lay these on the ground and let me fill you with eternal things. And so this is what we want to do. We want to sing a song that just says, I'm going to be honest. And we're going to show some clips of what we call red chair stories. Red chair stories are these beautiful stories. And we tell them because we don't want you to feel like you're alone. We're not. We're all in the same boat. And these red chair stories speak to the idea that we're broken, but that God can come in. That's what's happening in our community. We want you to see that. And I want you to sit in this song. And I want you to think about the mask that you might be wearing. I want you to think about the broken things that you know are there. And I want you to let God start to search your heart and start to reveal what those are to you.
I would talk to people and they would tell me the good news, and I would say, that's awesome. And I wish I could believe that. I think it would make life a lot easier.
Spent some time struggling with drugs and alcohol pre-college. I decided to start a path of trying to figure out what God meant in my life.
When I go to say my prayers at night to God, I was just pissed off with him. I'd say, I'm pissed off with you for 2 months. That's pretty much all I did.
It brought me absolutely to the very end of myself. I realized that I couldn't do it. There was no possible way that I could juggle everything.
It shook me. I said, Jesus, like, I'm done. Like, I'm done running from you. I want to experience the freedom that I know that you're gonna give me.
I just broke down and I was overcome, questioning. I'm like, God, what are you doing? Like, I don't think I can handle it. I don't think I have the strength.
Truth is harder than a lie. The dark seems safer than the night. Everyone has a heart that loves to hide. And I'm a mess and so are you. We built walls nobody can get through. Yeah, it may be hard, but the best thing we could ever do, bring your brokenness and I'll bring mine. 'Cause love can heal what hurt divides, and mercy's waiting on the other side. If we're honest. Pretend to be something that you're not. Living life afraid of getting caught. There is freedom found when we lay our secrets down at the cross. At the cross. So bring your brokenness and I'll bring mine. 'Cause love. we're honest, if we're honest, if we're honest.
Being authentic and being honest and being wide open happens, at least for me, in the best circumstances, when I feel loved and trust. And then you have this, and that is the heart of what God is. I love what Tim Keller, the pastor in New York, says. He says this, when he's explaining the gospel, the good news, the core of Jesus and his mission here on earth to take our brokenness. He says this, we as people are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dare dream. Because most of us don't think we're that broken and sinful, right? We are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dare dream. But at the same moment, we are more loved and accepted in Christ than we ever dared hope. That's the gospel to me. The good news is that God sent his son, Jesus. He knew from the garden, he's like, I know that there's this brokenness between us, between God, the Trinity, between us and our creation. We need a way back home. So he sent his perfect son to live a perfect life, to be on the cross and to take every bit of brokenness that the world has done and will ever do on in that moment. He's saying, look, I'll lay down my life for you because I love you that deeply. I want you that deeply. I know how I've made you. I'm going to take all that on. And when you come to me, I have this beautiful exchange. And so we're going to take communion. And it's in that spirit that I want you to take communion. Because a friend of mine says, you can't come to the table of communion. You can't come to God's table of communion where we take the bread and the juice that lets us remember the body and the blood that was spilled for us in this brokenness. You can't come there with masks on. You have to take the mask off. And you have to receive this as a gift. And so I want you to come to the table, lay your mask on. Now I want you to hold on to the bread and the juice after the song, and we'll take it together.
Father's arms are open.
About the first time communion was served. I think about, they said it was in the upper room where Jesus gathered with his close disciples. And there was brokenness in that room, by the way. One disciple was really broken. And I can imagine them sitting there and Jesus is telling them this. They have no idea what he's talking about. But he's like, here's the bread that I'm gonna give you and it's gonna signify my body and I'm gonna lay that down for you. I'm gonna lay my body down for you. I'm gonna have it broken so that I can take on this brokenness. Do this, what, in remembrance of me. And they're like, what? What are you talking about? And then here's the wine. This is juice. Here. This signifies my blood that I'm gonna pour out for you. Blood that it says in scripture will wash us white as snow. And they're confused, they don't know. But here it says, do this, what, in remembrance of me. Why do we have to remember? Here's why I think we have to remember. Do you realize what the disciples did after Jesus' death? They hid. Fear came in. They hid. His closest disciples, they hid. Peter, his very close, you know what he did? He went back to what he was doing as a fisherman. He left it. He lost his true self. He went back to his false identity. And Jesus is saying, listen, I'm giving you this Now, when Jesus came back and Peter saw him, he restored everything. He gave him this man. He's saying, this is why we take this gift of communion, to remember that there's a place to come back to in the person of Jesus. And we can have this unbelievable exchange where we give him our brokenness and he takes those broken things and he makes beautiful things out of them. And it's a long process. It's our lifelong process, but it's beautiful. And we get made new a little bit each day. What would happen if our community believed that to their core? What could this community do? People would walk in here and go, these people are freaks of nature. And we're like, yes, we're freaks of nature because we're supernaturally made by God. And we believe that identity. So that's what I want to take in the spirit. Let's take the bread together and let's take the wine together. Father, thank you for your son. Thank you for the sacrifice. Thank you, Lord, that we have a way home to be restored to who we really are. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that anyone in this room that has believed that their brokenness is who they are, that that is broken in the name of Jesus right now in this moment. It's not true. And that you draw them to you, the one true place. Thank you, Father. Pray all this in your name. Amen. Well, listen, anyone that feels like they want to talk, if they have anything moving in their hearts and spirits, we'll have prayer team here. We have prayer in the lobby as well. We'd love to talk to you. Baptism is coming up. If you are that person, this is your moment. And so it's 2 weeks. Sign up for that. Wednesday night, Lake Orion campus. This coming Wednesday, we have midweek. We'd love to see you there. And then we'll see you here next week for our next value. We love you and have a great, great weekend.